Am I annoyed? A little bit. Am I ticked off? Am I outraged? Not so much. This is Realistic Randy of the Mediocre Best Sports Podcast. The Minnesota Vikings lost to the Seattle Seahawks at Seattle. Final score of 21-7. It was a close game for the most part up until Fitz hits the shan for the Minnesota Vikings. And it's funny because when everything just lays out for the Vikings, where it's like the Carolina Panthers, they lost. Okay. Monday night football last week, the Redskins lost, and that propelled the Vikings, despite losing to the New England Patriots, that propelled them back to the number six spot as in the playoff scenarios if the playoffs started at that time. And then the Carolina Panthers, they lost on Sunday. And it's like, here you go, Vikings. Here's your chance to where you can control your own destiny just a little bit more than yesterday. And what happens? They screw up. They almost always fall apart in epic proportions. And by the way, we do this podcast twice a week. The early podcast in the week is now powered by 1500 ESPN. We out here, baby. I'm so humbled. I'm so blessed. I would celebrate with some champagne on this podcast, but I don't think the Hubbards would appreciate that. So I'd like to thank everybody that's been watching the show for this long. But getting back to this game, am I ticked off? I actually picked the Vikings to lose this game. As far as these back-to-back primetime games, I said that the Vikings actually had a better shot before these games started. I said that the Vikings have a better shot at beating the New England Patriots because their defense isn't even all that great. They have a chance to really make something happen at Foxborough, and that will really give them some good momentum going into the rest of the season. And then I predicted that they would lose to the Seattle Seahawks because mobile quarterbacks that can get outside the pockets, we always have trouble with them. And to the defense's credit, Danielle Hunter, he made a couple of really good plays. He got a sack on Russell Wilson to force a field goal, only gave up 3 points instead of seven. So Danielle Hunter saved 4 points off the board on that one possession. And then before halftime, the Seattle Seahawks, they were out there. It was looking like they were going to score a touchdown. It was fourth and goal or third and goal, whatever it was. And they were at the one-yard line, and Danielle Hunter forced Russell Wilson to throw an interception to Eric Kendricks. And Eric Kendricks could have possibly ran at him for a pick six. But you know what? Instead of, okay, worst case, we'll just settle for 3 points here, or best case scenario, we'll settle for 3 points. Worst case, we give up a touchdown. They gave up no points in that final possession to the Seattle Seahawks. So the Seahawks, or the Vikings defense, they were doing their thing for the most part in that game. They were containing Russell Wilson. They made a couple of plays here and there, but the defense was actually not bad. But the offense was garbage. I said it last week. John DeFilippo needs to be fired as of last week. I still stand by that. John DeFilippo needs to be fired. And before I get into that, I've been accused of being a Kirk Cousins apologist all offseason long. I was saying, bring in Kirk Cousins. I want Kirk Cousins. He's an upgrade over Case Keenum, and I still stand by that. But I can't defend this dude, Kirk Cousins, after that piece of crap I watched last night. Are you serious right now? And I get it. You don't have a good offensive line. I'll get into that with Rick Spielman in just a little bit. I get that, and I've never said that Kirk Cousins is one of those high-end quarterbacks where you can just build a team around Kirk Cousins. You're never going to be able to do that. He needs a good supporting system around him, and he doesn't have that. I get all that. But there were a couple of plays last night where I'm like, dude, you come out here. Before I even get into that, you go into the offseason. You think you're hot stuff, and I thought you were too, and I still stand by that. You think you're hot stuff. You use the Jets as leverage to up the ante as far as contract negotiations with the Minnesota Vikings. You're this and that. I haven't got my fair shake. I've been discredited my entire career, and here's your chance. Here's your chance to prove all the haters wrong, and you go out there. On, was it fourth down, when they did turnovers on down, they were at the goal line. Dalvin Cook was right there. Dalvin Cook, that check down was right there. And Dalvin Cook, all he had to do was muscle it in past, I believe, Bobby Wagner to get into the end zone. That was your chance right there. You threw it to Kyle Rudolph. It was contested. It wasn't there. I like the play call to go for it. Booger McFarland was like, go for the field goal. Go for the field goal. I don't like that. I like the fact that they were aggressive right there. You need to get a spark in this offense. But you threw it to the wrong guy. Dalvin Cook was right there. He could have ran it into the end zone. And then later on, I believe it was third or fourth down. I believe it was fourth down where Adam Thielen was open. Adam Thielen was open and you were just too late throwing the ball. This is the NFL. You can't be late on your throws. You can't be taking your time. And that's the thing. Kirk Cousins will throw some boneheaded passes where you're like, dude, what are you doing? And he's not the greatest quarterback of all time. He's not the greatest quarterback in the league right now. I get all that. And you know what? He's going to keep throwing those stupid where he gets his ball, where he gets his passes batted down at the line of scrimmage. If I'm not mistaken, most in the league right now. I get all that. But you need to show up. You need to make plays. You're supposed to be this $84 million guaranteed quarterback, and you are that. But you need to play like one. You're sitting here saying, I've been getting bleeped on my entire career. No one believed in me in Washington. They gave up on me, and I get it. Washington is a crappy franchise, but you still need to show up. You still need to be that quarterback and prove that you're that guy that deserves that money. So, Kirk Cousins, you don't get a pass. You need to play better straight up. As far as this season is concerned, the season's over with, okay? I know statistically it's like, oh, well, we need this to happen. It's over, okay? The season is all over with. John DeFilippo, let's get to this dude. Forget the fact that you basically replicated what you did in New England last week. The super scared, short yardage, playbook calling type of crap to where it's like just check down screens and left and right. You're afraid to call plays, to throw down the field. At one point, in the first possession, your offense is scared. Bobby Wagner, later on in that game, it was like in the fourth quarter. It was late in the second half, maybe late in the third quarter, early in the fourth quarter. Bobby Wagner was on a soundbite saying, basically, and I'm paraphrasing, like, they can't do nothing. They can't throw the ball. They can't pass. They can't do nothing. What is it about this franchise? Forget the offense and everything that's going on. This franchise as a whole, I've been following this team since 2000. I've been following this team for damn near two decades. This and because of Randy Moss, okay? That's the reason why I'm a Vikings fan. I'm not from Minnesota. I'm from D.C. I am a Minnesota Vikings fan because Randy Moss. Randy Moss is the greatest receiver of all time. You can't tell me nothing. But overall, this franchise is soft. The franchise is soft. Bobby Wagner knew it. Why is it that all these defenses, they go after all the teams that we go against, but primarily the opposing defenses with our offense? Why is it that they just get amped up? And by the way, the Seattle Seahawks, They were giving up every single opportunity to the Minnesota Vikings to win that game. They gave you every opportunity, but they were still getting after Kirk Cousins. They were still rushing the quarterback. They were still getting after him. I just don't understand why. You know how I watch a lot of animal documentaries like National Geographic and all that stuff, a lot of stuff on Netflix, and they say if you ever come into contact with a wild animal, you don't turn and run like a bear or something. You don't turn and run like that's your natural instinct like you want to do. When you do that, you set off their natural instinct as far as you are prey. They're going to chase after you. You stand your ground. If anything, you back up, okay? And then whatever happens, happens, okay? But that's the thing with opposing defenses. They see the Vikings, and the Vikings, they see them. They get scared, and you can see it in their eyes. They're just not ready. They're just not ready whenever it comes to these big-time games, and they look scared out there. They get chased. They look like prey, and you can see the opposing defenses. They're just salivating just to get after the Vikings. They are a soft team. But getting back to John DeFilippo, you want to call yourself a head coaching candidate? That's over with. We can release this dude right now. He can take all of his head coaching interviews 3 weeks before the season is over with. This dude, John DeFilippo, let's get this started off first. You want to talk about having an offense that's scared? The very first possession, 3rd and 4, you're making some noise. You're moving the ball. Dalvin Cook, he's getting a couple yards. You made a good play to Stephon Diggs, a good pass to him. Things are looking up. And then what happens? You get a delay of game. 3rd and 4 turns at 3rd and 9. Seattle, they rush Kirk Cousins. They bring on extra pressure, and you punt the ball. Then later on, you actually call a read option. Why are you calling a read option pass, right? A read option play, not even a read option pass. A read option play with Kirk Cousins as your quarterback. Normally with that type of play, you use it with like Cam Newton or Mitch Trubisky or who else is out there? Russell Wilson even. You use it with dude Lamar Jackson. Dudes that are explosive that can make plays where if the defense is collapsing on the running back, all right, the quarterback will take it back and they'll go to the opposite side. Kirk Cousins, he ended up handing the ball off to, I believe it was Dalvin Cook. And it's funny because why are you calling the read option play with Kirk Cousins as your quarterback? If I'm on the defense, if I'm a defensive lineman, or if I'm a linebacker and I see Kirk Cousins doing a read option, a zone read, I'm going after the running back every single time, dog. Because A, we know you're going to hand it off to the running back. And B, what? Flip. Let me ask you something, dog. This is a real live question. This is an actual question I want to ask, Flip. What do you think Kirk Cousins is going to do if he keeps the ball in his hands on a read option play? All right. Oh, the defense, they're going after the running back. Let me keep it. What do you think? You think he's an explosive quarterback that's going to make a play out on the edge? You calling a read option play with Kirk Cousins as your quarterback? Man, that's crazy. Dude, this dude, John DeFilippo, you're supposed to be an offensive coordinator, a head coaching candidate, and you're calling the most dumbass plays out there. Then on fourth and one, you ran the ball. Thankfully, you ran the ball. I was like, hey, run the ball. But you did with a little bit of creativity. You had C.J. Ham as your fullback opposed to, what was it, last week in New England, where you just ran the ball, single back formation with Latavius Murray, and you handed it off to Latavius Murray. But I'm like, why don't you have Dalvin Cook out there? Why is Dalvin Cook not allowed to be out there on fourth and one? Now, I know later on, they tried to run with him on a fourth and one, I believe, to try to get into the end zone. I don't remember what it was, and it just didn't work. I get that. But earlier in that game, they had a chance, fourth and one. C.J. Ham lines up at fullback, and they gave it to Latavius Murray. And Latavius Murray, I like Latavius Murray a lot, but Dalvin Cook is a straight north-south runner, lowers his helmet, buries in with his shoulders, and just goes straight forward. Latavius Murray, in that sort of situation, I'd be a little bit hesitant because he runs tall. He runs tall. He's basically like a 7-foot Shaquille O'Neal just trying to tower over people, and that's not going to work when you got 9-8 man in the box that's trying to bury into you. They know that you're running the ball. I just don't get that. And then later on, what was it, third and one, you call a play-action bootleg. Are you serious right now, John DeFilippo? You call, after being successful on quarterback sneak, after quarterback sneak, you ran, I believe, two or three successful quarterback sneaks in that game, and you call on third and one or fourth and one, whatever that was, you call a play-action bootleg. Punt the ball, game over, doesn't matter. Are you serious right now? Dude, you're a fraud. You need to be fired. You need to be gone. This, and what's interesting is, going into this next guy, Mike Zimmer, you don't get a pass either. Mike Zimmer, you are 9-9. Here's the thing. Forget everything that I say about Mike Zimmer as far as how you think I feel about Mike Zimmer. I've been saying this all along. I don't think, if this franchise wants to go where it wants to go as far as trying to win a championship, Mike Zimmer cannot be your head coach. I'm sorry. I've seen enough. Forget how I feel about it. He gets all up there and big and bad, and I wish the media members would go after him more. And I don't understand, whenever I criticize Mike Zimmer, and it's all facts, I'm just bringing up stuff that's happening. He's the head coach, but whenever I criticize Mike Zimmer, oh, but the defense was good. The defense was great. Oh my God, you can't criticize him. It's not his fault. He's the head coach, bro. He's the head coach. He oversees this entire team. Since Mike Zimmer has taken over as head coach of the Minnesota Vikings, the Minnesota Vikings are 9-9 in nationally televised games, okay? That's not including the playoffs. If you include the playoffs, they're 10-11. Your team is an average-ass team when it comes to the big moments. When it comes to the bright lights, everybody seeing you, this is your chance. The big games, this is time for you to step up, baby. And what are you? You're the Cincinnati Bengals. You are an average head coach, okay? You're not going to be able to. Mike Zimmer is so dependent on offensive coordinators, okay? The defense has been good ever since Mike Zimmer has got to this team as a head coach. Look, I will give him this. He has turned this defense around. Our defense was crap with Leslie Frazier as the interim head coach and Brad Childress as the head coach before that. I get that. He has turned this defense around. But overall, as far as the overall team and success, he's dependent on the offense. Adrian Peterson, what I believe, if I'm not mistaken, he was the leading rusher in 2015, and it was just this extra just bend but don't break type of offense. And then 2016, you don't make the playoffs at all. Your defense was actually better than compared to 2015. Your offense was crap. Offensive line was even crap. Norv Turner leaves. You bring in Pat Shurmur as what, tight ends coach. He ends up calling plays for the rest of the year. You finish 8-8. Then Pat Shurmur gets a whole offseason to be the offensive coordinator. And you know what's interesting? Compare last year with Pat Shurmur to this year with John DeFilippo. One of the few times that, as a Vikings fan, you looked at the, as far as of lately in the 2000s, because certainly in the late 90s, early 2000s, it was Randy Moss, Dante Culpepper. The offense was amazing. But this was actually, as far as the later 2000s, last year compared to this year, last year's offense was like, it wasn't explosive. It wasn't this miraculous kick-ass offense or anything, but it was super, super efficient to where you could sit back and be like, oh, I wonder what Pat Shurmur is going to conjure up today. I can't wait to see what happens. And it was just, you could breathe easy. You could just relax. Now with this offense in 2018 with John DeFilippo, with Flip, this offense is so excruciating to watch, where you're just sitting there just like in 2016. Every yard that they get is an absolute grind. And that's ridiculous with the talent that we have, that this offense is so just stagnant. It is unbelievable. But Mike Zimmer is so dependent on offensive coordinators, whether they're good or not. And here's what's interesting about that. Whether our offensive coordinator is crap or whether they're brilliant, every single year, we're going to end up with a new offensive coordinator. Why? Because if you're a crappy offensive coordinator, what's going to happen? You're going to get fired. If you're a great offensive coordinator and you make this offense shine like Pat Shurmur did last year, you're going to go be a head coach somewhere else. So we're going to keep going through this yo-yo effect of offensive coordinator after offensive coordinator. Meanwhile, this dude Mike Zimmer, oh, we're just going to have this kick-ass defense and we're going to stop. Why? Why is it that that has to be our bread and butter? Why can't we have a more balanced team? And I think that George Edwards could be a better defensive coordinator than Mike Zimmer. I think he's shown the ability to do that. I think he called plays, if I'm not mistaken, was that 2016 against the Dallas Cowboys? I'm pretty sure that was the game where Mike Zimmer, I think he was going through eye surgeries or whatever it was, and George Edwards had to fill in for him. He called a pretty good game. I think we could be really good with George Edwards, if not just as good as we are right now, with George Edwards as our defensive coordinator, and we need to go out and find an offensive-minded head coach. But in the big games, when it's time for you to show up, you are average at best. I'm sorry, I just don't see it. I don't understand all the excuses we come up for this dude. He's not a glorified defensive coordinator. He is the head coach of this team, and it's time for this dude to stop getting a pass. Then we get to Mike Zimmer. Rick Spielman. Okay, just went off on Mike Zimmer. Rick Spielman. Mike Remmers has been a disaster out there at right guard. We already knew, and I said I was very skeptical of it. I was like, why are you going to have this dude play guard? Because you didn't draft one in the draft. You should have moved up, tried to get one. We've gone through this time and time again. I'm not going to rehash that. But your mastermind solution, right? We're going to put Mike Remmers, we're going to take him from right tackle, we're going to put him at right guard, and he's going to be fine. It's going to be great. I'm going to be executive of the year. Are you serious right now? Now he's been a disaster. There were two, if I'm not mistaken, there were back-to-back offensive possessions. If it wasn't back-to-back, I know it was two different times that Mike Remmers gave up pressure on third downs that forced the punt, basically forfeited possessions because of Mike Remmers. There's no reason, and I understand, and now, and I see throughout Twitter, the Twitterverse and everything, we need to get rid of Mike Zimmer, or Mike Remmers, and he's terrible, and I'm so sick of Mike Remmers, and I get it. He is an easy punching bag, but he was relatively decent at right tackle. I think it has been inexcusable what Rick Spielman has did to Mike Remmers. Rick Spielman has single-handedly sabotaged Mike Remmers' career. He should have stayed at right tackle where he belonged, and you should address the interior offense linemen, specifically the two guard spots. I don't get it, man. You sat there, you want to experiment instead of trying to address this offensive line for real. You want to go out there and just try to be cute and all by going out there and getting a damn kicker. And I said this earlier in the season where I said, hey, I don't want to hear a damn thing about this offensive line because we got Mike Hughes, baby. We got Mike Hughes, and oh, he's hurt. I get that he's been hurt. But come on, man. If he's been healthy, what was he going to do? That offensive line would still be crap, right? Are we serious right now? And by the way, Holton Hill, he's played really well. I get that. And Danielle Hunter, he's played really well as well. The defense has been good. And I think the linebacker play has slipped off a lot. But overall, the defense has been good every single year under Mike Zimmer. Okay? Guess what? The success of the team, you're talking about what? 8-8? Not counting 2014. 8-8. Then in 2015, you win, 11-5. Or 2015, you went 11-5. 2016, you went 8-8. 2017, you went 13-3. And now this year, you're 6-6 and freaking 1. And that one tie was because of Rick Spielman for deciding we don't need Kai Forbath. We're going to go out there and get the sexy kicker, the guy that just the best kicker in all time in college sports, and Daniel Carlson, guess what? He's been doing fine with the Raiders. And I don't care. Mike Breaver, you should be fired too. Mr. Can't have your special teams organized in New England last week. Matt Wiles just sitting there getting drunk on the sidelines instead of getting out there to be the placeholder for Dan Bailey. I knew he was going to miss that kick. But what's interesting is whether Daniel Carlson turns out to be a great kicker or not, it didn't matter. We didn't need him. A, you don't need to draft the kicker. And B, we don't have the time. Even if he was going to be great with us, we didn't have the time. This was a window this year. You signed Kirk Cousins for a reason, damn it. We didn't have time to sit here and nurture a kicker to say, okay, we need to work on this. We were a team that was ready to win right now, or so we thought. And the reason, and you know what? Let's just get this out the way. The season's over with. Unless the Vikings to make a miracle turnaround and unless the universe decides to align for the Vikings again, Rick Spielman needs to be fired. We need a GM that's going to take this team seriously. John DeFilippo needs to be fired as of this recording. Hopefully he's fired by the time this is uploaded. And me personally, if I were Rick Spielman, well, no, if I wasn't Rick Spielman, if I were the Wilf brothers, I would fire Rick Spielman. I would fire John DeFilippo, and I would fire Mike Zimmer. I understand if you want to keep Mike Zimmer for one more year. I get it. I know a lot of people say, oh, he shouldn't be on the hot seat. He should be on the hot seat. This dude has been in, what, his fifth season right now? You can never get your team ready. You are the Cincinnati Bengals. It's crazy because you came from the Cincinnati Bengals. But Rick Spielman, what's interesting is the thing that just ticks me off with Rick Spielman, he's a really good GM. He's really good. He's really smart. This dude was in 2016, the offseason before 2016, Teddy Bridgewater goes down, right? You lost in the playoffs, in that playoffs before that, Blair Walsh screwed it up. I was calling for that dude's job for years before that happened. But anyway, Blair Walsh misses the field goal against Seattle. You lose in the playoffs. That following year, 2016, you're like, oh, we're going to do something. We're going to make something happen. We're going to carry that momentum we had last year, baby. We're only going to get better. And then Teddy Bridgewater goes down with that horrific knee injury. And what does Rick Spielman do? He goes out there. He puts on his GM hat and he says, you know what? Screw that. We're not going to settle with Sean Hill as our quarterback. I'm gonna surrender a first-round pick to get Sam Bradford. And that was the right move. I stood with Rick Spielman ever since he did that. It just didn't work out because of health issues, but that was the right move. It's stuff like that where it's like Rick Spielman, he knows what he's doing, but he tries to get cute too much time. Rick Spielman is too damn smart to be doing this much dumb stuff year after year after year. We've had offensive line problems forever, dog. For the last several years, we've had offensive line problems, and you keep going through the same merry-go-round. It's like, no, it's fine. It's fine. Patchwork offensive line will be better. You didn't take this year seriously. You wasted a year, Rick Spielman. If it were up to me, Rick Spielman, Mike Zimmer, John DeFilippo, fired. All of them. George Edwards, you can keep them. And did I say Mike Prefer? You can go too. Fire them. Fire them, and then see what happens after that. I understand if you want to give Mike Zimmer one more year, but Rick Spielman and John DeFilippo, you should really, really be gone right now. You're frauds. You want to be cute, and you think you're this and that? Go be cute somewhere else, all right? So anyway, we now do this. We do this twice a week. Now, the earlier podcast is on, powered by 1500 ESPN. The second podcast will be on Saturdays. You can find it on YouTube. Just look up Realistic Randy, and you'll find it. We'll see you on Saturday, baby.